Hello. Oh, no, not yet. That's a trial run. Hello, good evening. Welcome. My name's Reverend Anne. I'm one of the team vicars here in this parish. And it's really great to welcome you all here to this Nuneaton Deanery Confirmation Service. And I know that we've got people here from quite a few different churches. We've got people here from Attleborough. Give a wave. Yay. St. Paul's Stockingford. Give a wave. Yay. Bedworth All Saints. Yay. Brilliant. It's fantastic that we're all here to celebrate all these candidates getting confirming their faith. It's a real privilege. Just a few notices. We are wearing masks throughout the services, but unless you're exempt for any reason. And when you come up for communion, if you keep your mask on, take the wafer, and when you go back to your seat, you can consume it at that point. I think that's all in terms of COVID. Just obviously be mindful of people in terms of space. During the offering here, we have a bit of a tradition where we come forward to give. You can probably see a couple of stations already. And the idea is that, we're coming to give our offerings to God. And there is also a sweet treat there as well. So you can, whether you're giving or not giving, please do feel free to come and take a chocolate or a sweet, a sign of God's goodness to us, that he gives us good gifts. Brilliant. In terms of communion, you will be directed. We'll show you. There'll be someone there to just show the way, and we're going to have two stations. One station in the middle with Bishop John, another person on this side, and then gluten free will be on the right hand side. And I think the last notice in terms of how the service is going to work is at the end, during the hymn, we are going to be following Bishop John and the candidates out into the outside, and we're going to do the very last bit of the service outside. So do be ready to do that. Great, I think that's it. So let's stand, and we're going to sing our first hymn, which is Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven.
Thank you. one Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God and Father of all.
Peace be with you.
And also with you.
It's a huge joy to be here at All Saints, Bedworth. I hope I've covered the bases on that one. And for a deanery confirmation, I have felt for some time, and I shared this with the clergy fairly recently, the clergy of this deanery, that God is really doing a new thing in this deanery. And that is so exciting. And obviously God is doing a new thing in those who are taking the step into confirmation, trusting their lives to God in a new way, in a new commitment. And confirmations are really important and give joy not only to us, but in heaven. There is joy in heaven when anyone takes a step towards the Lord. And God always honors those steps of faith. So it is really good to be part of that tonight, to share in the confirmation. And an opportunity for all of us, because as that lovely, quite old song now, One More Step Along the Road, there's another step for each of us to make. There's more for us to enter into that God has for all of us. So as we celebrate tonight, as we pray, as we praise, let's all of us actually re-trust our lives to God. And God knows how we've come. He knows the burdens we carry. He knows us far better than we know ourselves. And so let's just keep a moment of quiet now before we go any further. And in that quiet, if it feels right for us, just to say, here am I, Lord. I'm glad to be with you. I'm glad to be with brothers and sisters in Christ. And I want to meet with you tonight. So let's just offer something like that prayer, whatever's real for us, in a moment of quiet. Heavenly Father, by the power of your Holy Spirit, you give your faithful people new life in the water of baptism. Guide and strengthen us by the same Spirit, that we who are born again may serve you in faith and love, and grow into the full stature of your Son, Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated. Anne-Marie is going to be sharing her story of the journey of her faith. And this is going to come up on the screen in a minute. But I know that each candidate here has got an incredible story of faith and in terms of their journey, and would love to share it with you if you ask them. So do be asking all the other candidates as well their stories. But let's listen to Anne-Marie.
So you're Anne-Marie.
Hello.
Brilliant. So do you want to start by just telling us a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, I have a husband and two wonderful children, and I was born in Bedworth, lived in Bedworth. Are we going to stay in Bedworth?
Brilliant. And so can you tell me a little bit about your journey of faith, your experience of faith?
Growing up, my experience of faith was probably very sparse. It was more of something that you just filled on a form, you know, at hospital, say, I'm Church of England, and things that you do at school, like hymns at assembly and that kind of thing. But there wasn't really an active participation of church, my family or anything.
Mm-hmm. And so how did your faith change?
Well, when I met my husband, his family were actually really strong in their faith, but they never kind of put pressure on me to explore it further if I didn't want to. And then but I still felt like I needed to make an effort or something. So I went to church, but because it was for other people, it didn't ever really click, because obviously if you're sitting there and you're not really letting Jesus into your heart, actually. So because I didn't really get anything from it, I was thinking, oh, you know, this isn't for me. So it wasn't until then we came to church again and you suggested the Alpha course that we went along to. I went along to the Alpha course, and it's when you get to ask all the important questions and anything that's kind of like that you didn't understand or things that you were concerned about, and I probably annoyed you with difficult questions. But then it was actually really good because we were able to explore everything, things were explained, and it was a really safe space. And by the end of it, I was like, actually, do you know what? I want this for me. This is something that I want to do. And as soon as I made that decision and said, yes, do you know what, Jesus, I want to be a Christian, I burst into tears, didn't I? I was emotional. I had to turn the camera off because it's done over Zoom and everything. And it was a real emotional, and it just filled me.
Yeah, brilliant, brilliant. And so what difference has Jesus made in your life since then?
There's been a day-to-day change. Before, I used to suffer a lot with anxiety and stress. And so day-to-day, it's almost like you're able to say, do you know what? I'm Jesus, I'm giving this to you. I don't need this baggage, this weight. You know, I don't want it. I'm going to give you this, and you know what you want for me and everything. And I'm just going to concentrate on the things that I need to concentrate and not worry about all this stuff, which day-to-day, you can imagine, it's just really lightened me up just being able to feel so much more joy. And then there's been actual really significant things. I have a family member who had a medical issue. And for years and years, we weren't able to get a diagnosis or any help, and it was just going round and round. And then one day at church, after something was said in the sermon, I burst into tears. And lots of lovely people came over, asked what was wrong, and a couple of people prayed for this family member. And then in a matter of months, all of a sudden, we've got a diagnosis. We've got things in place that are going to help. And people might say it's a coincidence or something, but that was through prayer. So that's an actual, real, tangible, significant thing, the difference that Jesus has made, not in just my life, but my family's life as well.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, that's so amazing. Wow, that's incredible. And so why do you want to get confirmed today?
As I said before, previously when I've dabbled in faith, it's been for other people or because of what is expected or to try and make other people happy, but this is actually now for me. This is about me saying, no, this is my relationship with Jesus and God. This is for me, and this is what I want to do. And this is, you know, confirming that, yes, I'm a Christian, and I'm happy, and it's joyous.
Yeah, brilliant. That's fantastic. Thank you so much, Anne-Marie, for sharing your story. I know it would be a real encouragement for many to hear, and for your family as well and friends. So, yeah, so thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, let's put our hands together. Thank you, Anne-Marie. That was a wonderful testament. And it reminded me, when you talked about, some people say it's coincidence. I think it was Archbishop William Temple, but it's certainly one of the archbishops, was being interviewed by very sceptical press. Journalists are often very sceptical as part of their job. And he was talking about prayer, and that God listens and answers prayer. And they were saying, oh, no, that's just coincidence. To which he said, well, I find when I pray, coincidences happen, and when I don't, they don't. So thank you for that testimony. And as Anne has said, there are plenty of other wonderful testimonies in this room. And actually, in the Church of England, on the whole, we've not been good at sharing faith or our journeys of faith. And actually, we discover when we do, God always honors that. And we grow in faith as we witness to Christ, and others receive from God at work, Christ in us, from that. So my prayer is that all of us will be... across the whole church, actually, will grow in witnessing, and that can begin. I sense it happens perhaps more here than in some parts of this diocese, where I think some people haven't shared their journey of faith with people. people they've been worshipping next door to for the last 20, 30, 40 years even. I mean, that can happen. And as a Church of England, I pray that with God's anointing, we will grow in sharing what God has done in us. So thank you all for that. And I meant to say a huge thank you to Anne for organizing this wonderful service. And we're really blessed with a fantastic organist and a wonderful music group. Wow, gosh. I've already been blessed by both of them, so we will continue receiving that blessing. Indeed, even now as we sing Light of the World.
Step down into darkness, open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here
Wonderful. So do sit down, and Latoya will read the first reading.
A reading from the book of Samuel. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At the time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim, so dim that he could not see, was laying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out. And Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." And he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel, Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I didn't call you, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore, Eli said to Samuel, "Go and lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for you, your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him, and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you so much, Latoya, for that reading. We stand for the gospel.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark 1, 35 to 39. Glory to you, O Lord. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Simon and his companions went to look for him. And when they found him, they exclaimed, "Everyone is looking for you." Jesus replied, "Let us go somewhere else, to the nearby villages, so I can preach there also. That is why I have come." So he traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out demons. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Samuel said, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." And so we pray, "Speak, Lord, for your servants, your children, each one of us is listening." And so we pray that you will open our ears to hear what you would say, Lord, to each one of us personally, and to what you would say to us as your people in this deanery. And we pray too that you will soften our hearts, that they may be receptive to your word of life. And we pray that you will strengthen our wills, that we will trust and obey that word. And we offer this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Please do sit. The readings tonight are what we call, a strange word, the lectionary readings. They are the set readings. They're not readings I chose, but I think they are spot on for tonight. Samuel needs to listen to God. And before he is attuned to do that listening directly to God, he needs Eli to point him in the right direction. He thinks it's Eli calling. Jesus gets up while it is still dark, early in the morning. The paragraph before in the Gospel, we read, Mark tells us that the whole of Capernaum, great crowds come out because people have got to hear that Jesus heals people. So the day before he was in the synagogue in the morning, he healed Simon's mother-in-law in the afternoon, and in the evening he's ministered to huge crowds of people coming with their needs. So he was fully human as well as fully God, exhausted. And what does he do? He doesn't have a lie-in the next day. He gets up early to listen to his Heavenly Father. Prayer is more about listening than speaking. It is about listening. It is about speaking, but it's very fundamentally about listening to God, listening for God. So Samuel listened to God. Jesus listens to God, getting up very early in the morning to pray. Remember, he says, I can do nothing of myself, only what I hear from the Father. And you have been listening to God, the eight of you coming to confirmation. Like Eli and like others, you have listened to God through people. God speaks in so many ways. You've listened to God through people. You've perhaps sensed God in people. And you've been drawn to God through seeing that Christ is making a difference in the lives of others. So God has spoken to you through people. God has spoken to you through, I trust and believe, the Holy Scriptures. And has stirred up in your heart, inwardly, a desire to turn to face God. So three listenings already. Samuel listening to God. First, he needed a human being to point him, to alert him to God's word and to the fact that God wants to speak to him. And God wants to speak to you, to each of us. You know, Paul describes every Christian as a saint. You know, we can think, oh, God wouldn't want to speak to me. Well, he does. Sometimes parents used to say, or maybe grandparents to children, you've got two ears and one mouth, so you should listen twice as much as you speak. And that's good wisdom for adults, too. Listen twice as much as we speak. And actually listen to God and listen to the person in front of us at the same time. So listening. God wants us to listen. The prophets again and again, God speaks to them and says, come to me, come listen to me. Come listen and live. Come to my word and live. Feed off it. Come to me. Listen. And in that moment of extraordinary revelation of the glory of God in Jesus at the transfiguration, what do Peter, James, and John hear? This is my beloved son. Listen to him. So tuned in are we to listening to God? I think we miss out, and I always include myself whenever I'm preaching. I've got huge L plates on my back. I think because a disciple is a learner, and any Christian who thinks he, she has got it all is far from the truth. There is always more. A spirit is the spirit of truth, and there is more, as we read in the epistles, growing up into the stature of Christ for whoever we are to do. So God calls us to listen. Why? Because what we're about is not religion, it is relationship. What we're about is relationship. God says, I no longer call you servants, but friends. God wants to enjoy an intimate, deep, real relationship with him. Because his love is personal. I will be saying to the eight to be confirmed just before your confirmation, God has called you by name and made you his own. So many people still think, because some of us are so bad at trusting, daring to believe how much God loves us. But God is passionately in love with you. One extraordinary woman, Catherine of Siena, said in one of her prayers, O Holy Trinity, you who are madly in love with us. And just think of God in those terms. And passionately in love is the right word. You see the depth of the passion of Christ on the cross. That is how much he loves you. And he wants us to know that love, not just here, but in here. And so that is why God sends the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. We need the Holy Spirit for that relationship to come to life. And the Holy Spirit has been at work in the eight of you to bring you to this point. It is God in us that draws us back to God. And you've each got different stories to tell, and that's wonderful. How dreadful it would be if God was calling only one kind of person. That is the furthest thing from the gospel. God has created all sorts of people, and every person in his image, and every person can reflect his light in a different way, as in a prism, the different colors of his light and his love. And sometimes we think, and I'm actually encouraged by the number, I'm encouraged when anyone takes a step of faith, but I'm confirming, and people are confirming, people in every age bracket. Now, I did a confirmation quite a few years ago now in Ettington in the diocese, and there was someone confirmed in every decade from 10 to 20 up until 80 to 90. And that's wonderful. It's never too late, but the time is always now. That's the paradox. Never too late to turn to Christ. As the thief on the cross discovered shortly before he died. Never too late, but the time is always now. I went to an exhibition in St. Mary's Cathedral in Edinburgh in August, and it was a depiction of the Last Supper in porcelain. So you had the figure of Christ and the 12 apostles in porcelain, and it is a Japanese style of art, and it's called kintsugi, and it was new to me. I've discovered lots of people don't know anything about it, but some people do. It was new to me, and kintsugi comes from the Japanese philosophy, which is that things that have been broken, A, should not be wasted, and can become even more beautiful when brought together with gold lacquer. So kintsugi pottery, porcelain, is made up of broken pieces. And the end result, they're all brought together and sealed with gold, lacquer with real gold in it. So the end result is more beautiful than before they were broken. And that to me was a wonderful picture of the redeeming love of God. And it's a reminder that actually we need, to a degree, we need to have been broken open. Broken open of any idea of our self-sufficiency, that we can save ourselves. We need to be brought to the place of knowing our need of God. And whenever we're there, God does amazing things. And our struggles in life and our pains and our griefs and the bruises we bear and the scars, if offered to God, and if we don't let them embitter us, that's another possible response, isn't it, to become bitter and hard-hearted if we suffer, and cynical and or fatalistic. But if we dare to bring these wounds and breakages to God, God can do and will do extraordinary things through us. And we will be far more powerful in our witness than had we never been broken open and never got to the point of saying, Lord, I need you. I cannot do it myself. And any life that is open, and Jesus confirms this again and again in his teaching, doesn't he? That it is in that place. The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit. God will not despise. God is so present and longing to reach out and touch the broken parts of our life if we bring them to him. And that enables us to be much more powerful in our witness. It gives us a deeper heart of compassion because we have suffered. And people kind of get it. If we've been through something and we're really listening to them as Christians, and that listening, which is honoring them and is not listening, rushing to give the right answer, which can be a temptation to some people, it's the unconditional love of Christ reflected through us, but reflected through us even more powerfully, as with the kintsugi analogy, because we've lived a bit. We know what it's like to be rejected or the other wounds that we can bear. So just as it is by his wounds that we are healed, so our wounds, if brought to Christ for his healing, can be instruments of healing to others we encounter in everyday life. And so to the eight of you, but actually however many people in church too, don't underestimate what God wants to do through you. You know, you are each of you has a unique vocation. Every day is full of opportunities to witness. Jesus gets up early. C.S. Lewis really stresses this in his writing, the importance of praying, and it's actually only doing what Jesus did, very first thing, the moment you open your eyes in the morning, you know, not reading long prayers, I'm not talking about that, but this is the day that the Lord has made. Here am I, Lord. But before the busyness of the day crowds into your mind, where you're most receptive to God, and just offering the day to God, and then these coincidences, which are God incidences, will manifest themselves. It might be a chat in the supermarket. It might be meeting someone, walking the dog. It might be in the pub. All these so-called chance encounters, like Philip and the Ethiopian, are not chance if you've given the day to God in advance. And God will do extraordinary things through you. And I give you, the eight of you, this challenge to be alert to the promptings of the Spirit so that this time next year Bishop Christopher or I are confirming people that you have been alongside in their journey, and they would say that they have met with Christ. They've been encouraged in their journey through your walking with them on as Christ, because Christ lives you on their Emmaus journey. So God loves you, God wants to use you more and more, and each one of you is just as important as any great saint, you know, so-called. You know, you are uniquely precious to God. And let's rejoice in that and how much he loves you. And I really look forward to what God is going to do through you. And the confirmation, finally, is not just you coming, and that's a really important thing, but it also involves a commission. So you are called and you are sent. That's true of all of us. So if we sit on our faith, we lose it. If we give it away, we grow in faith. So let me close with a prayer. Lord, thank you that you use frail earthen vessels, cracked pots, as Paul writes, for the treasures of your kingdom to be in us. And thank you, we don't have to be anyone else for you to love us. You love us passionately right now, this moment, just as we are. And so help all of us, we pray, whether we're being confirmed today or not, to put our lives back in your hands. And thank you, Lord, for all your love, and that your love grows in us as we share it. And may you be glorified in our lives. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And so let us stand to sing, "Bless the Lord, O my soul." Invite the congregation to sit, but the candidates for confirmation, please stay standing. Thank you for making those presentations. Perhaps those of you who are to be confirmed could just turn to face the congregation so they can see your faces. Your wonderful faces. And now to turn back to me, please, because I'm going to ask you these very important questions. Some of you perhaps were baptized, I know some as adults, but some perhaps when you were very small indeed. You will be declaring your own faith now before being confirmed. Have you been baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit?
I have.
Are you ready with your own mouth and from your own heart to affirm your faith in Jesus Christ?
I am.
And now a question for everyone here, so please do answer full of volume and enthusiasm. People of God, will you welcome these eight wonderful people and uphold them in their life in Christ?
With the help of God, we will.
Good. Well, they sound like they meant it, so great. Because we do need to support one another. Being a Christian is not solo flying. We need each other in the body of Christ to support each other, encourage one another, speak the truth in love, pray for one another, and so on. In baptism, God calls us out of darkness into his marvelous light. To follow Christ means dying to sin and rising to new life with him. So I ask the eight of you, do you reject the devil and all rebellion against God?
I reject them.
Do you renounce the deceit and corruption of evil?
I renounce them.
Do you repent of the sins that separate us from God and neighbor? Do you turn to Christ as Savior?
I turn to Christ.
Do you submit to Christ as Lord?
I submit to Christ.
Do you come to Christ the way, the truth, and the life?
I come to Christ.
May God, who has given you the desire to follow Christ, give you strength to continue in the way. Amen. And so some of us are now going to gather at the font. Traditionally, fonts, as you know, at the back of the church, symbolizing that baptism is the doorway into the Christian faith. But we gather around the font for confirmations to remember our baptisms. It's important to remember our baptisms, all of us. Martin Luther apparently reminded himself every day, I have been baptized. So baptized into Christ. So I have the infinite riches of Christ to draw on each day. So some of us will now gather around the font for the declaration of faith. And I invite all of us to stand for that. Brothers and sisters, I ask you all here in church today to profess together with these candidates the faith of the church. Do you believe and trust in God the Father?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ?
I believe.
Come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
And as a reminder of their baptism, I'm going to be sprinkling the candidates and those standing close to them. You don't do things by halves here, you know, because baptism in the New Testament actually means drench, so you're getting off very lightly. And I'm going to be true to my word.
Thank you.
That was with your consent. Yes. Alison can't escape that easily. So we now return to the place of confirmation, and I invite the, there's one prayer here. So if you've got it on the screen, I invite you to join in with me in saying this prayer. Almighty God, we thank you for our fellowship in the household of faith with all who have been baptized into your name. Keep us faithful to our baptism, and so make us ready for that day when the whole creation shall be made perfect in your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. So do please sit or kneel for prayer during the confirmation, and we will go to the place of confirmation now. The candidates can go to their places. And we are all here to pray for the 8 to be confirmed, but please do also pray for yourself, for a fresh experience of God, for a sense of God's presence, and that his Spirit will refresh you. God knows your needs better than you know them, and we know them ourselves. Our help is in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Almighty and ever-living God, you have given these your servants new birth in baptism by water and the Spirit, and have forgiven them all their sins. Let your Holy Spirit rest upon them, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and inward strength. the spirit of knowledge and true godliness, and let their delight be in the fear of the Lord. Amen. Rosalind, God has called you by name and made you his own. Confirm, O Lord, your servant Rosalind with your Holy Spirit, Amen. Marlene, God has called you by name and made you his own. Confirm, O Lord, your servant Marlene with your Holy Spirit. Amen. Sarah Jane, God has called you by name and made you his own. Confirm, O Lord, your servant Sarah Jane with your Holy Spirit. Amen. Anne Marie, God has called you by name and made you his own. Confirm, O Lord, your servant Anne Marie with your Holy Spirit. Amen. Deborah, God has called you by name and made you his own. Confirm, O Lord, your servant Deborah, with your Holy Spirit, Amen. Latoya, God has called you by name and made you his own. Confirm, O Lord, your servant Latoya with your Holy Spirit, Amen. Anna, God has called you by name and made you his own. Confirm, O Lord, your servant Anna with your Holy Spirit. Amen. Jeanette, God has called you by name and made you his own. Confirm, O Lord, your servant Jeanette with your Holy Spirit. Amen. So let us all pray together for those just confirmed. Defend, O Lord, these your servants with your heavenly grace, that they may continue yours forever and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more until they come to your everlasting life. Amen. We continue in prayer.
So as we continue to pray, we're going to use two verses from the Psalms to focus our prayers. For God alone my soul waits in silence. From him comes my salvation. Father, we thank you for sending Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you came to save us. And we thank you that it's not just that particular day and time when we committed our lives to you. But day by day, you save us from so many things. Sometimes from the wrong choices we would have made, the wrong path we would have gone down, the wrong situation, the wrong people we may have engaged with. Thank you for saving us in so many ways. Thank you for being our Saviour. The things we don't even know that you have saved us from, we thank you for saving and protecting us. Thank you for your plan that you've laid out for us. We give you praise. For God alone, my soul waits in silence, for my hope is from him. Thank you, Father, for the hope that you give us. In good days, in dark times, thank you we can rely on you. For hope. We pray our hope will rise as we pray for our nation, for our politicians, for our Queen, for us as individuals who make up our society. We pray, Father, that hope will rise as we pray for these big issues within our nation. We pray that as Christians, we will contribute and bring salt and light into our communities, into our parishes, into the families that you have placed us in. Give us hope to expect good things from you. We pray for the church across our nation, the church across the world, the church in the places where you've planted us. We pray, Father, that we will play our part in whatever you've called us to do, in whatever way you want our lights to shine. We pray that our lights will combine to make a real impact in the places we live. And we especially pray tonight for these new lights that you have lit in Ros, in Marlene, in Sarah Jane, Anne Marie, Deborah, Latoya, Anna, and Jeanette. We thank you for each one who has heard your call. We just pray that we will each, in whatever way you ask us, be supportive to these people in our congregations who are our friends and part of your body. And we pray for people here tonight who may not have responded yet to your call. Holy Spirit, will you continue to woo them and to speak to them? And all of these prayers we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen.
So I invite you to stand for the peace. I go around, as you can imagine, a lot of different churches, and there are different in these COVID days, ways of exchanging the peace. I believe in this church it's a wave, but do your own thing. You could do what you do in your church. But anyhow, it's wonderful to be sharing together in the peace that Christ alone can give. God has made us one in Christ. He has set his seal upon us, and as a pledge of what is to come, has given the Spirit to dwell in our hearts. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Looks like you're waving goodbye. So we're going to sing the wonderful truth that in Christ alone our hope is found. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life, So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. And now we give you thanks because by water and the Holy Spirit you have made us a holy people in Jesus Christ our Lord. You raise us to new life in him and renew in us the image of your glory. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord. God of heaven and earth, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me.
Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ died, Christ risen, Christ will come again.
And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption as we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. We bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people. And gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we in the company of all the saints may praise and glorify you forever. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. As our Savior taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. I invite you to join with me in the prayer that follows. God of mercy by whose grace alone we are accepted and equipped for your service, stir up in us the gifts of your Holy Spirit and make us worthy of our calling, that we may bring forth the fruit of the Spirit in love and joy and peace, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so, having been called, we are also sent. So I invite not only those just confirmed, but everyone else here who would like to join in the commission. God has called all of us and sends all of us to join in. So please do stand for the commissioning, the sending out. Those who are baptized are called to worship and serve God. Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in the prayers? Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord? Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ Jesus? Will you seek and serve Christ in all people, loving your neighbor as yourself? Will you acknowledge Christ's authority over human society by prayer for the world and its leaders, by defending the weak, and by seeking peace and justice? May Christ dwell in your hearts through faith, that you may be rooted and grounded in love and bring forth the fruit of the Spirit. The God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ Jesus, establish, strengthen, and settle you in the faith. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. So the candidates, they're no longer candidates, those confirmed will be illuminated now. That means not set on fire. but given a candle is a sign that you are bearers of the light of Christ. So I think that is in hand. Whilst that is happening, I forgot to say I have brought a Gideon's Bible to give to each of those of you who have just been confirmed. You will know that they are quite small and you can take them around with you in your pocket or your bag. And I find them really helpful and important, just to read something that words Jesus has spoken in the course of the day, you know. So don't leave without me having given them to you. So how many of you are a light? Oh, they look rather wonderful candles. Two more. And some have got clever things to stop you burning your hands, and the others haven't. So St. Paul's Stockingford are very brave because they trust the candle wax won't fall on their fingers. But they're all wonderful. So has everyone got one? Eight of you? Yes. So God has delivered us from the dominion of darkness and has given us a place with the saints in light. You have received the light of Christ. Walk in this light all the days of your life. And our final hymn celebrates the resurrection of Jesus, who is the light of the world. Thine be the glory.